But let me just say, I have a lot of respect for Phil Haney, folks. Phil, his folks, his book is called, by the way, See Something, Say Nothing. It's subtitled, A Homeland Security Officer Exposes the Government's Submission to Jihad. I want to talk about Benghazi. I want to talk tonight about the AQIS and Code of Conduct. That's probably new to you. It's new to me. Phil tipped me off about it, and I started reading about it this afternoon. But before I do, I want to get into this perfect storm and the cargo containers, and then ask you three reasons why you think Benghazi happened and what that was really all about. Phil, I brought this up to you today in our conversation. I did two shows on radio last week on this. Tuesday, I'm going to be interviewing Claire Lopez, who is a former CIA officer. This report comes out of the Center for Security Policy. But the bottom line is, our government has given a 35-year lease to a man by the name of Jaffer, last name is Jaffer, who is, well, he was connected to Saddam Hussein. In fact, this report states the following about Mr. Jaffer. It states that he was Saddam Hussein's, one of his chief nuclear experts. He was also involved in biological and chemical development. He was on a target list. The government was able to go after him during the Iraqi Operation Iraqi Freedom. He has a company now that he works with called Gulftainers, and its co-owners are the Iraqi Jaffer family. They're in joint venture with Russia's Rostec, owner of Rosoborne Export, the Russian state-owned exporter of the Club K container cruise missile launch system. Now, folks, if you haven't seen the Club K cruise missile launch system, basically you can go on YouTube, type that in, you'll find real videos of it. You'll find simulated, but then you'll also find real videos of it where it's being displayed at various fairs and festivals around the world, and it looks like a shipping container that you'd see on the back of a railroad car or on the back of a semi-truck. It comes in on a cargo ship, is offloaded, and then can be put on a semi-truck or a rail car, and they can be distributed all over the U.S. And with the push of a button, commands from a satellite, it opens up and up launches the launch system for four cruise missiles. And the NORAD has admitted, according to this report, they cannot track them. If they're here, they would have no way of tracking and knowing they're here. Well, this guy Jaffer, his company is in a relationship with Rosoborne Export, the Russian state-owned exporter of the Club K car. Remember, in addition to this, he was Saddam Hussein's mastermind scientist behind his nuclear program. And the company he's connected to, Gulf Container, our country just gave a 35-year lease for his company at the cargo terminal of Port Canaveral there in Florida. Another fact of this report is that Dr. Jaffer was on the Operation Iraqi Freedom blacklist as an Iraqi regime official who could be engaged as a military target, yet we just gave his company a 35-year lease. Dr. Jaffer sought a missile delivery system from North Korea shortly before Operation Iraqi Freedom, and North Korea planned to build a missile factory in Iraq. He also helped to miniaturize nuclear weapons that appear strikingly similar, or that North Korea has miniaturized weapons that appear strikingly similar to Dr. Jaffer's miniaturized nuclear weapon known as the beach ball. It weighs less than a ton. It looks like a beach ball, and it is a powerful nuclear weapon. It's a miniaturized weapon. Now, the question is, could they put some of these nuclear weapons on these cruise missiles, biological, chemical warfare, regular standard nuclear weapons, and launch them? In fact, if they were to launch them, just one Club K car with four cruise missiles could take out an aircraft carrier. They go on to state in this report that a Russian defense journal bragged in 2015 about such a scenario, launching these off of barges on rivers, launching them from cargo ships in international water, launching them from semi-trucks, railways, and just flat rail cars placed on the ground throughout America. And yet, one of the people involved in this is a gentleman that Barack Obama's administration put into power and in position to let this go through. His name, Amin Meir, and he was the staff chairperson from 2009 until 2014 for a government National Treasury, or the Department of Treasury division known as the Committee on Foreign Investment in the United States. It's a national security post at the Treasury Department. Well, this Amin Meir was the staff person from 2009 to 2014. And he has connections, according to this report, to Muslim Brotherhood, as well as many other troubling people. And of course, this is also when the committee, according to James Rickers, this advisory committee with this Treasury agency that's supposed to advise and approve or not approve potential security threat problems, that advisory subcommittee, according to James Rickers, was shut down, which allowed Uranium One to go through and this deal as well. Tell us, Phil Haney, what you know about everything I just laid out to our listening friends.
Well, I'd like to add another piece to the puzzle while we're at it. We've all heard of Citgo, right?
Yes.
Citgo gas stations. There are 14,000 Citgo gas stations in America. Do you know who owns Citgo?
No idea.
Venezuela. Venezuela owns Citgo. And because Venezuela has been going through economic crisis, they sold their refineries in America to Russia. So now Russia owns Citgo refineries in the United States. Some of them are in Texas. So you have a huge tangled ball of string here. You have petroleum, you have uranium, you have shipping containers, all involved with elements from either the Middle East or Russia, both of them who pose a threat to us in some way or another. And as I mentioned to you earlier, I focus mainly on the Muslim Brotherhood and other Salafi Muslim groups from around the world. So the fact that Amin Mir, who has known affiliations with the Islamic Society of North America, has been put in this position of making these critical decisions about who to allocate our resources to is beyond my ability to exaggerate how serious this is. I know a lot of adjectives, but I can't even think of the adjectives that would be adequate to describe how ominously dangerous it is to have a Muslim Brotherhood operative closely affiliated with the Islamic Society of North America, a known connect to Hamas, in a position of authority like this. It's what I call saturation. The Muslim Brotherhood has saturated into the social, into the political, into the law enforcement, and even into the military arenas in our society. And this is just one of many possible examples that I could give you. So you've got individuals with known derogatory associations going clear back to Saddam Hussein. You have Muslim Brotherhood operatives. You know who knows who from Venezuela involved because of Citgo and petroleum. And then the Russian component of this whole messed up situation. How in the world did we ever get to this point where we've got these individuals who have come in and are taking over major components of our social and our infrastructure?
Well, Phil, if you say Citgo now owns some of the oil refineries here in the U.S. Citgo owns them, but now Russia owns a big chunk of Citgo that they bought from the financially troubled Venezuela. So you're now telling me that Citgo refineries in the U.S. are now owned by Russia. Is that what I just heard you say?
Yeah, they did a fire sale, dime on the dollar, to raise capital. Let's say about 6 months ago, it was during the summer when this all happened. And Citgo, again, is owned. There's 14,000 gas stations, plus or minus, in the United States, and it's a wholly owned subsidiary of Venezuela's oil industry, selling oil. And when Venezuela was more normal country, then it was all right. But now they've descended into anarchy and chaos and left to socialism. And they're also, let's not forget another piece of the puzzle. There's also Iran. Iran is part of this Rubik's Cube as well, because Iran has close affiliation with Venezuela.
But the part that troubles me, Phil, is you're now saying, though, that Russia owns a big chunk of Citgo, if not all of it, but they own a big chunk of it, and that includes these oil refineries in the U.S., which means you've got cargo shipping containers coming into the U.S., you've got other things coming into the U.S. through Port Canaveral with this Dr. Jaffer, with his connections to Saddam Hussein, with his connections to the company that is state-owned that exports the Club K car. Now we have reason for Russia to be moving cargo containers throughout the U.S. to their different oil refineries, which could just as well have the Club K cargo launching missile systems inside of them, correct?
Well, yes, it's correct. And the ominous thing about it is that every one of these layers, complex layers, removes them further and further away from enforcement and scrutiny. There are so many different front groups, shell groups, and companies involved in these negotiations that it would take financial specialists with the FBI weeks, if not months, to unravel all of it.
Well,
it's all interrelated.
One more thing here.
I'm reading the headlines now. Venezuela's new $5 million bond deal involves Citgo and Russia. $5 billion. And so on. You can just query it right on your cell phone and find Venezuela state oil firm default would cause problems for U.S. And they're going to sell interests in 8 U.S. oil refineries. So Russia's Rosneft, I think, did you say that name? Rosneft, it's a Russian petroleum company, is involved with this deal. So it's something to look into. And it's just one more example of the complicated relationship, if you want to call it that, between Middle Eastern actors, Russia, South America, and why the point is that our elected officials, who as Americans we feel we trust that they have our best interests in mind, have abrogated their constitutional responsibilities and put us at threat that is so deep and broad that we can't even find words to describe it anymore, because it's so complicated with so many different moving parts in it, that unless, like I say, you're with the FBI or some intelligence agency, you can't even keep track of it. And the average American doesn't know that any of this is happening.
No, they don't know any of this is happening. And the company I mentioned was Russia's Rostec, owner of Rosenboron Export, the Russian state-owned exporter of the Club K container cruise missile launch system. By the way, before we move on to Benghazi, James R. Clapper, according to James Rickards, who I've interviewed on radio several times, he was part of the national intelligence community and the support group of the and worked with this national organization, or this United States committee from the Treasury Department that's supposed to be reviewing these kind of contracts and put them through a 30 to 45 day review before you give leases and contracts to certain companies, like giving a 35-year lease to this Dr. Jaffer connected back to Saddam Hussein and the Russians, and now his company has a 35-year lease in Port Cape Canaveral for cargo terminal system. Well, Rickards knows what he's talking about because Rickards was a part of that, and he tweeted out October 18th, 2017 that the director of the National Intelligence, James R. Clapper, quote, disbanded, end quote, the CFIUS-DNI advisory group before Uranium-1. So perhaps that's how Uranium-1 went through. But not only did the Uranium-1 deal go through, which gave, you know, several, well, it was like 20% of our uranium to the Soviets, to the former Russia. This also allowed this contract to go through to give Dr. Jaffer's company 35-year lease on this Port Canaveral. So you get investigated, Phil, for doing your job. Why has James R. Clapper not had a special prosecutor to look at him and what is possibly perjury before Congress, according to this report?
Well, that's only things that we're beginning to discover. How many more of these kind of arrangements and deals are we going to find out about as the weeks and months go on? I don't believe that this is the last of them that we will find out about. James Clapper is the one, by the way, that notified the American public that the Muslim Brotherhood has no global agenda and that they've renounced violence and that they're not part of terrorism and that they would be good partners to work with. That's James Clapper. And so, as far as I'm concerned, his credibility was shot a long time ago. But to hear about these different Obama officials who have made these quid pro quo deals with foreign governments, just like Hillary Clinton did. She wasn't the only one. She was just one of many in the Obama administration that were making these special arrangements. And I believe that's really the reason why they fully expected her to win the election. It's because, well, they not only expected her to win, they were counting on her to win. Because if Hillary Clinton had won the election, all of these kind of scandals that we're talking about would have been buried in a mass grave. And we would have never heard about any of them. Or what we heard would have been just the merest hint of it. And we would have been prevented and hindered from looking into it. Now, at least, we have an opportunity, a hope, a possibility that we will be able to go forward and find out what really happened. But if she had been elected, friend, this stuff would have all been buried deep underground.
My guest is Phil Haney. He's author of the book See Something, Say Nothing, subtitled A Homeland Security Officer's Expose, A Homeland Security Officer Exposes the Government's Submission to Jihad.